For more on all of this, America's lawyer, Ring of Fire Radio host Mike Papantonio. Pap, good to have you with us.
How are you, Ed?
Gotta save Mary Landrieu. How's that for a punchline?
Yeah, you know, Ed, in terms of policy, I don't think it'll matter if Landrieu wins or loses her runoff. She only calls herself a Democrat because up until now it's been beneficial. She's taken in more than $1.5 million from the oil industry over the years, and she's just another bought and paid for fossil fuel senator. I mean, she probably, if you want to know the truth, she's probably dead man walking right now in that runoff. Bill Cassidy's using Keystone as his focus to defeat her. And there's a real irony, even though she's been a vocal proponent of the XL, it is who can XL each other right now.
And yeah.
Cassidy,
by the way, Cassidy, the vote in the House today, he's co-sponsoring that too.
Yes, of course. And yeah. You've got the Republicans who are going to bring it, you know, to a vote in the House, as you've pointed out. There'll be enough blue dog Democrats to make any veto by Obama meaningless. That's my prediction. It's unlikely that Obama would veto it anyway, if you want to know my opinion on it, Ed. In his incredibly weak, lame duck position, it's not something he would go out of his way to do. A veto-proof vote is going to give Obama cover. I suspect he wants to say that there's nothing he could do. This is probably the perfect scenario. If we would have seen him take an action earlier, we would have understood, yeah, he's clearly against the notion of Keystone. I've never been convinced that he was. Up to this point, the Senate's refused to hold a vote on the pipeline in order to allow Obama to remain uncommitted through the midterms. But right now, you've got Landrieu, you've got Joe Manchin, and nine other Democrats, possibly 9 to 10 other Democrats that are going to support the pipeline.
Yeah. Here's Senator Hoeven talking about the veto threats of the Keystone XL. Cut 9.
We're going to try to move energy legislation in the new Congress, a variety of bills. And remember, it's going to take Democrat support. You still need 60 votes in the Senate to move a bill, and obviously 67 if the president vetoes. So I think what you'll see, it will likely be part of broader energy legislation, possibly an appropriation measure if he vetoes it. But, you know, this is a test case, and if there's a lot of Democrats on board, maybe he won't veto it. We'll see.
Interesting. The question to Hoeven, the senator from North Dakota, was, do you think that the president's going to veto anything that comes to his desk dealing with Keystone? He, of course, says, well, there's going to be a number of energy bills that are going to come his way. Well, they're all going to have Keystone on it. So if his standalone bill doesn't get it and gets vetoed, there's going to be more stuff coming his way. This is what they want. They want to sell out to the multinational. They want to take the risk of putting the pipeline over the aquifer. It's bad for America. It's too risky. It doesn't bring down gas prices. It doesn't make us any more energy efficient or any more energy independent. So why go down this road, Democrats? Pap, when are they going to prove that they're serious about climate change?
Well, Ed, there's more to the story to me. The more to the story is the division that we're going to start seeing within the Democratic Party. You started your broadcast by talking about Warren taking a leadership position, but you're going to have industry henchmen, blue dog Democrats like West Virginia's Joe Manchin, for example. He's going to be yelling that now is the time for the XL. What he's really saying there, Ed, is not now is the time for the XL, but now is the time for the progressives to get the hell out of the way and let the blue dog Democrats take over. He, of course, is the senator from a state with the worst environmental record on the books, mountaintop mining, toxic spills into waterways virtually every month, a coal industry gone insane, chemical industry pollution in this country only second to Mary Landrieu's Louisiana. So it's not just about this. This is, if you heard Manchin beating on his chest 2 days after the election, where he was saying, you know what, by God, I'm not going to get in the way of what the Republicans want to do. Of course not. He is a Republican, and this is part of this division.
The sell job by Mary Landrieu on Keystone XL has been going on for a long time. This is her comment last spring, cut 4.
It relates to the Keystone pipeline and the decision that you are going to make, and the administration's going to make, about a critical, in my view, piece of infrastructure that will transport safely the cleanest barrel of oil produced in North America.
I choked when I heard that. And I absolutely choked when I heard it. I'm going to tell you, we called Senator Landrieu's office and asked them, this was back this spring, and asked them to clarify, how do they know it's the cleanest? stop with the bullshit. I mean, come on. This is not the cleanest barrel of oil. It's the most toxic. And so the bottom line here is they never got back to it.
And the reason it takes more money to refine it because it is so toxic. And really, when you take a look,
that's why they want to put it down to the Gulf, because those refineries are the ones that can do it instead of building ones up north.
Have you ever been through? If you've been through Chemical Alley down there in North Carolina, you understand down through Louisiana, you understand that's where everything flows. It's like a dumping ground for all types of toxins. But this particular line, look, inspection is almost non-existent. You've got flyover inspection that would occur at most every 3 weeks. And you got foot patrols. This is interesting. They say they're going to have foot patrols that'll occur if a leak's detected. The problem is a pinhole leak anywhere in this pipe is going to release up to 700,000 gallons per day.